Sunday or whatever we're supposed to be today. Are we on? Yeah, you know? Oh, I'm not even turning on. All right, let's try this again.
All right, how about that? There we go. Oh, there we go. Okay. Man, I'm gone to America for a week and I come back and don't turn my mic on. Good. I want to thank you all for our well wishes. We had a wonderful time. It was such an honor to be a part of the baptism of our nieces and to see family and friends. And you know what? They let me back into Canada. So how about that? That's a praise in and of itself. So it's good to be back here with you, church family. For here at Victory, we aspire to be a church for the city, building families and impacting the community. I want to turn our attention this morning, first off, to our sanctuary lamp. This morning, our lamp burns in memory of Phyllis Kennedy, mother of Bev, Collodia, and Glenn Kennedy, who passed away on June 21st of 2022. So we remember and celebrate Phyllis today. Some other family news, our dear sister in the Lord, Thelma Schneider, has gone to be with the Lord. Funeral details will be forthcoming, so stay tuned for that. As well as our beloved sister in the Lord, Doris Franco, has passed on to be with the Lord as well. Her funeral will be here at Victory at 11 o'clock on Friday. Here on Friday at 11 o'clock for Doris. So we remember and celebrate our dear sisters. You may notice this morning that up here is our awesome praise team and myself, but we have another significant person that is not here today, our dear leader, Pastor Roland. He's off sunbathing on the golden sandy shores of Bow Island, from what I understand. He is ministering Trinity Lutheran in Foremost and Zion in Bow Island, which is a privilege to do so, which means that this afternoon I get the opportunity to worship with Burstall and Hilda. It's great to remember that we are a part of a kingdom that's beyond our four walls. A couple of things here. As our ministry goes beyond the four walls, you have heard the past couple of weeks that the Medicine Hat Area Refugee Team, MHART, is gathering things for a new family, refugee family from South Sudan. And all that is left is they need a lawnmower and four lawn chairs. That's it. So if you have some extra lawn chairs or know of any or a lawnmower, talk to Gene in the office about that. Thank you guys for your generosity in helping this family out. Speaking of helping out, you may notice if you attend Victory regularly, parking becomes a fun adventure on Sunday mornings. I went over and talked to our friends over at the Apprenticeship Building, the brown building right next to A&W, and they said on Sunday mornings there are 18 spots that are available for our use. So they're the ones immediately surrounding the brown Apprenticeship Building next to A&W. So those 18 spots are ours. To use on Sunday mornings. So if you are able-bodied, you're not carrying car seats or children or instruments or whatever, what have you, and you're able to park back there, we invite you to do so to help alleviate some of that adventure that takes place on Sunday mornings. Today represents the last for a couple of things here as we head into summer. Today will be our final coffee time together, our final coffee hour for the summer, as well as today is the last Sunday school as we head into summer. We will continue to have kids' sermons and kids' activity packets, but today will be our final Sunday school before we get in until September. This also means that next Sunday, as you probably heard Pastor Roland say last week, next Sunday, June 30th, we go to our one service summer worship time at 10 a.m. Next Sunday for July and August, one Sunday service at 10 a.m. So if you arrive at 10:30 next Sunday, Pastor Roland will already be all into his sermon and wondering why you're coming in half hour late. So 10 o'clock next Sunday will be our summer worship time. That begins next Sunday, 10 o'clock, June 30th. 10 o'clock next Sunday, June 30th. The other thing we do want to announce as we head into summertime, while some of our groups take a break, we go down to one service. This does not mean that our relationship with Jesus takes a break for the summer. Quite the contrary. So one of the things that Pastor Roland has done, it was in the last Victory Voice, it's printed off in the back, is what's called a Psalm Challenge. Working our way through each of the Psalms this summer, we have that printed for you, as well as we printed some more lectionaries. These are each of the different scripture readings we do each and every Sunday that you can grab as well. As a way for us to stay connected with each other, to stay connected with a service while you're out wherever you go on holidays over the summer, as a way to stay connected with the Word of God and ultimately then with Christ. And so Psalm challenges and printed lectionaries are available for your use over the summer. So with that, I would like to invite up our handbell choir to prepare for their piece. Today we have several pieces by our handbell choir as we wrap up the handbell season. Thank you, Handbell Choir, for starting our service in that way. I invite us to rise together this morning. Friends, we begin our worship, entering into His grace and His mercy. as we experience his forgiveness. And we do so in his name, the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, God has promised forgiveness to all who truly repent, turn to Christ in faith, and are themselves forgiving. And so in the truth of his forgiveness and of his mercy, we take a moment then to examine our own sinfulness, a moment to come clean before the Lord. Merciful God, we have sinned in what we have thought and said, in the wrong we have done, and in the good we have not done. We have sinned in ignorance, we have sinned in weakness, we have sinned through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry. We repent and turn to you. Forgive us for our Savior Christ's sake, and renew our lives to the glory of your name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, through the cross of Christ, God have mercy on you, pardon you, and set you free. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. God strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue our worship singing together, Here I Am to Worship. And so we pray together the ancient litany, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O Christ, hear us. God, the Father in heaven. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world. God, the Holy Spirit. Holy Trinity, one God. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Give us peace. Amen. We pray, O God, our defender, storms rage about us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair. Deliver your sons and daughters from fear and preserve us all from unbelief. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and as you are, I invite the kiddos and kids in the house, come on down. Move this so everybody can see you. All right. Oh, good. One more. Awesome. Come on down. How are we today? Everybody looks very summery and happy, huh? Summer is just about here. School's about done. It's going to be like 50 soon and all that. Yeah. Good. Getting all ready to swim and to go in the summer. So I got a question for you. I want to start with this. Have any of you, one of the things that happens sometimes as we get into summer is our thunderstorms. Have you guys been in a thunderstorm before? How many of you guys have ever been in a really big storm in your life? Anybody ever been in a really big one of any kind? All right, tell me what it was like. What was it like to be in a real big storm? Yes. It was scary. Yeah, they can be pretty scary. I saw your hand raised. What is it like? Was it cool? Yeah, pretty cool. Lightning and everything? Yeah, I like lightning. What else? What is it like to be in a storm? What was it like? What do you remember about being in one? Anybody? Yeah? What? You can run in the rain. Yes, you sure can. Hey, bud, come on up. I remember this one time I was visiting a relative in a paradise called Iowa, and we were in this place called Iowa, and we were having supper, and all of a sudden the sky changed, and these alarms started going off, and my relative said, okay, we got to get down to the cellar. And so we all went down to the cellar. It was super cool in there, this big screen TV and Nintendo and all this stuff. And so we're down in the cellar because the thunder was like shaking the house. It was shaking the house, rattling the windows. Stuff was falling off the mantle. There it is, by the fireplace. And we went down because a tornado came about a mile away from where we were. Didn't get us, thankfully, but it was crazy. Another time, we were in another paradise called Weyburn, Saskatchewan, and we're out in Saskatchewan, and I'm outside, and we're playing baseball with some neighbors, and all of a sudden, the sky turns a really weird green color, and the air gets real still. And, oh, this is weird, and then we started hearing thunder, and there was some different lightning, and the wind started picking up, and then, guess what? Alarms went off on our phone. Tornado warning. And our neighbors are all freaking out, and they're running around trying to see the tornado, and some people drove in their car to go watch it. Not what you're supposed to do. But so I ran downstairs to our basement to get everything ready in case we had to go down. It hit like 10 kilometers away, so it didn't get to us. But it was pretty scary. I agree. Sometimes storms can be really scary. In our Bible reading today, Jesus is with his disciples, and they're in this little wooden boat, and they're out in the middle of a lake, and suddenly a storm comes up. And it was like a hurricane. Huge waves, they're coming. Imagine this, okay? Let's pretend we're in this boat. Huge waves are coming over the boat. The winds are whipping around. There are no phones. There's no Coast Guard. We don't have life jackets. We're just out there and getting really scared. You know what's wild during this story? Jesus is asleep the whole time. He's in back taking a nap. So he doesn't even know the storm's going on. And the disciples get really scared. And they're like, Jesus, wake up. We're going to drown. This is super scary. The waves are big. Huge lightning and thunder. And you know, does anybody know this story? What does Jesus do? Yeah. Yeah, he makes it calm and makes the storm stop. Jesus gets up in front of the boat, and he holds his hands out, and he says, peace, be still. The storm goes silent. The waves are all, there's no more waves. The water goes calm. The skies part. Sun comes back out. The storm is gone. Pretty wild. What does that tell us about Jesus and who he is? What do you think? He's what? He is a miracle, and he's a miracle worker. You bet. He did miracles. He still does them today. What else? What else does that tell you about Jesus, that he can get up and stop an entire storm just like that? What do you think? Yes. He can do anything. You bet, because he is God. He's almighty. Yeah, he commands even the storms. And so what this reminds us of, and what I want us to think about today, is as you guys go through your life, you got a lot of life ahead of you. You're going to have different stuff in your life that maybe is not fair. You're going to have stuff in your life that's really hard. There's going to be stuff in your life that maybe is painful. Maybe that even caused some tears. That they're going to happen in life. But when we look at this story, we remember that even when those happen, Jesus is bigger than all that. That we can pray to him. That he never leaves us. That he can calm any of the storms in our life. And that we can always go to him. Because he loves you so much that he died on the cross for you. Okay, so I want you guys to stand up. Congregation, if you would like to extend a hand forward, we're going to pray over our kids. Lord, we thank you for our kids. Thank you for who they are, who you're crafting them to be. We just ask, Lord, as they grow up and go through life, and when different tough things come in their life, may they never forget you are with them. May they never forget that you love them. May they never forget that you can calm the storms and the different tough things that come up in their life. May they always trust in you. Amen. Amen. All right, kiddos, off you go to Sunday school. Have a great time. And with that, I invite our reader to come forward this morning.
Our first reading is Job 38, 1 to 11 from the New Living Translation. Then the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind. Who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words? Brace yourself like a man because I have some questions for you and you must answer them. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you know so much. Who determined its dimensions and stretched out the surveying line? What supports its foundations and who laid its cornerstone? As the morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy. Who kept the sea inside its boundaries as it burst from the womb, and as I clothed it with clouds and wrapped it in thick darkness? For I locked it behind barred gates, limiting its shores. I said, this far and no farther will you come. Here your proud waves must stop. Psalm 124. What if the Lord had not been on our side? What if the Lord had not been on our side? They would have swallowed us alive. The waters would have engulfed us. Yes, the raging waters of their fury. Praise the Lord. We escaped like a bird from a hunter's trap. Our help is from the Lord. Second reading, 2 Corinthians 6, 1 to 13. As God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. We live in such a way that no one will stumble because of us, and no one will find fault with our ministry. In everything we do, we show that we are true ministers of God. We patiently endure troubles and hardships and calamities of every kind. We have been beaten, been put in prison, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, endured sleepless nights, and gone without food. We prove ourselves by our purity, our understanding, our patience, our kindness, by the Holy Spirit within us, and by our sincere love. We faithfully preach the truth. God's power is working in us. We use the weapons of righteousness in the right hand for attack and the left hand for defense. We serve God whether people honor us or despise us, whether they slander us or praise us. We are honest, but they call us imposters. We are ignored even though we are well known. We live close to death, but we are still alive. We have been beaten, but we have not been killed. Our hearts ache, but we always have joy. We are poor, but we give spiritual riches to others. We own nothing, and yet we have everything. Oh, dear Corinthian friends, we have spoken honestly with you, and our hearts are open to you, there is no lack of love on our part. But you have withheld your love from us. I'm asking you to respond as if you were my own children. Open your hearts to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Please rise for our gospel acclamation. Friends, our gospel this morning comes to us from the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 4. Glory to you, O Lord. As evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's cross to the other side of the lake." So they took Jesus in the boat and started out, leaving the crowds behind, although other boats followed. But soon a fierce storm came up. High waves were breaking into the boat, and it began to fill with water. Jesus was sleeping at the back of the boat with his head on a cushion. The disciples woke him, shouting, "Teacher, don't you care that we're going to drown?" When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Silence, be still." Suddenly the wind stopped and there was a great calm. Then he asked them, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" The disciples were absolutely terrified. "Who is this man?" they asked each other. "Even the wind and the waves obey him." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue singing, "Where Could I Go?" Let us pray. Lord, we do declare that today, where could I go? As Scripture says, Lord, you have the words of eternal life. To whom else can I go? We come to you this morning to your cross as we sang, "Here I am to worship." As we enter into your word, may we praise your name and draw ever closer to you. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, I was thinking this morning, as we have the handbells going on today, we had to replace some light bulbs. I'm going to come preach over from here today. Variety is the name of the game at Victory Lutheran Church. So here we are. You know, this past week as I was down in America, some people were asking me, what is Medicine Hat like? What is it like to live in Medicine Hat? How would you describe it? So I talk about, well, Medicine Hat, we live the desert life. We live the desert life in Medicine Hat. And they said, it's Canada. There's no way you live the desert life. I said, isn't it minus 50 in Canada? And I said, well, yes, but we also get the other side of things too. We get the hot summers as we're about to enter into today. Usually it's a fairly dry climate. We have cactus here, as the wheel on my bicycle found out the hard way. We have snakes, there's sagebrush and juniper trees, sand. Some of you may find how wonderful sandy soil is in your gardens and lawns. The desert life. So it can be a little harder for us to imagine and place ourselves in the scene that we find in the gospel this morning of a hurricane force storm. Our version said fear storm, but that doesn't quite cut it. The Sea of Galilee, it would be hurricane, typhoon-style storms out on the water in a rickety-dinky little boat. As growing up on the coast, I can recall seeing storms batter the beaches and the coastline. I can remember hearing tales of storms at sea. My dad recalls a storm coming up on his fleet while he was in war games near Korea. He said, watching the waves go over the guns of the warships. My uncle told me of waves battering his aircraft carrier while following a typhoon in the Navy. Now, you and I can try to imagine that. Maybe we do a good job imagining that, but being in a small wooden fishing boat with no Coast Guard, no communications of any kind, no life jackets, no life rings, in the midst of a howling hurricane, that might be a bit harder to contemplate. Now, perhaps it's better for us here to think of when a plow wind hit our farm. Perhaps you've experienced a tornado, or like myself, when I was telling the kids, gotten close to experiencing one. Maybe you've been in that once-in-a-lifetime tremendous thunderstorm. Or perhaps you have been in a hurricane, a monsoon, or a typhoon as you've traveled outside of Alberta. Regardless of your experience, storms hit, and they feel completely out of your control. Look at our gospel reading today, the disciples. It said, the scripture said they were absolutely terrified. They woke Jesus up from his nap and said, we are going to drown. They're saying, we're going to die. This is it. The other passages of scripture in our readings today remind us that though we may never experience a hurricane, we may never experience a tornado, we may never experience a storm at sea, we do experience them in our life. Through what life throws at us. And we think about that laundry list of what life throws at us. A significant fight with a spouse. A shouting match with the kids. A blow-up at a family gathering. Arguments at church or on the way to church. That's never happened. A financial unforeseen disaster. Perhaps a tragedy of a loved one. Getting fired or laid off from your job. That sinking realization, realizing I'm not going to be able to pay this bill. Receiving from a doctor a frightening diagnosis. The list can go on and on and on and on. Our reality this morning is that you and I live in a fallen, broken, imperfect world. Sometimes things happen and sometimes they are completely out of our control. Things happen that, quite honestly, are not fair, and you do not deserve it. Another reality, though, is that you and I are also fallen, broken, and imperfect, too. That there are times when we do, let's face it, there's no better word for it, something dumb. We do dumb things that bring consequences that we very much do deserve, and suffering ensues, sometimes for years down the line. So question this morning is, what do we do in these challenges? How do you and I react in the trial? Or perhaps a question we ask, where is God at in those? Our scripture beckons us to deal with these questions, ones that we absolutely must face in our lives. The reality here is that trials and life struggles are nothing new. The world is the world and has been the world for a very long time. Humans are humans and have been humans for a very long time. Christians for the last 2,000 years have been wrestling with and thinking about this. And as we look at what they have written over the past 2,000 years and we turn to our scripture, there's honestly some hope. There's some assurance and gives us some things to think about as we walk through our life's struggles and trials here today in 2024. The Apostle Peter spends time writing to suffering Christians in his first letter. Now, these Christians are suffering. They are experiencing torture, and they are experiencing execution, being thrown alive to wild animals, being burned at the stake, being crucified, being whipped, being thrown into prison. Probably things that you and I have not experienced. But as he's writing to these suffering Christians, he reminds them, and thereby us, that before we reach the joy and the blessing of eternal life in Jesus Christ, we first experience the afflictions in this life. There was a song that was on the radio the other day that said that heaven is a place here on earth. Now, I think St. Peter would listen to that on the radio and he would say, no. We have to experience this life before we get to that one. As one of the sayings says, you have to walk your path before you get to St. Peter's gates. And as we go through this life, we have to remember, the Apostle Peter says, even in suffering, that we have been purchased by the cross through the very blood of Jesus. We must never forget that we are baptized into his flock, into his family. That you are chosen by him. And so we seek to live in that identity even when life is very, very hard. St. Paul in our Corinthians reading this morning, he speaks of the trials that he's gone through. He says, we've been whipped, we've been beaten, we've been on the wrong end of an angry mob, we've been thrown into prison, we've had sleepless nights, we've gone without food, we've been abused and tossed out of cities. And he says that he brings us to the truth that God's strength works in our human weakness and in brokenness. That the Lord is working in and through us, even in the trial, even when we cannot see it. It can be hard to remember that he is at work. It can be hard to remember, especially when things get tough, that he is in control. Nearly 2,000 years ago, an early church father named St. Cyril, he looked at this passage of Christ that we looked at this morning, and he said this, let us be like the waves. Let us be like creation, and like those waves, submit to the Lord, for he remains in control. Perhaps you've read this passage 1,000 times, maybe you've never thought about that. What if we were like the waves? For when Christ got up and said, peace be still, what did the waves do? They stilled. They calmed and they submitted themselves to him. What if we were like that too? St. John Chrysostom points out that often in our life's struggles, we end up submitting to sin and we detach ourselves from God. Perhaps we can think of times where we went down that road. In the midst of great challenges and struggles in our life, we turned to an addiction, perhaps. We turned to emotions that ended up consuming us. We went to things that made us feel better in the moment, but in reality made the situation even worse. Rather than turning to that and turning to those things, Chrysostom states that there's actually training in the trial. That we can come out as champions of the gospel if we seek to go down that road and seek to make that choice. As I was reading that this morning, my conversation with myself was, well, that's much easier said than done. When we are in the storm itself, this isn't easy. What these fathers and saints are saying is this isn't downplaying any of our life's storms. In fact, not at all. But rather, it's looking at our perspective, changing how we look at things, seeing God in the storm, and taking a step back and looking at how you and I walk through the trials of life. Osenimus puts it this way. He said, "In our affliction, we can learn to find complete dependence on God rather than on ourselves." In our affliction, we can learn to find complete dependence on God rather than on ourselves. Who do you depend on? This really comes down to trust. Jesus calmed the storm. He said, "Peace be still," and the storm stilled. The gospel makes that absolutely clear. As a pastor says, sometimes he calms the storm. Sometimes the storm rages and he calms you. It comes down to the trust that is in our hearts. Friends, trials will come. Struggle will come. That is 100%. That is a guarantee. To say, you know, I'm going to live a life where everything is easy and nothing ever goes wrong, that's completely delusional. So when the storm and trials come, and they will, remember that you have been purchased by his very blood. When the storm and the trials come, remember whose you are. When the storm and the trials come, remember that his strength is at work even in our brokenness. As scripture said, "My power is made perfect in weakness." When the storms and the trials come, and this may be the hardest one, remember who actually is in control and who has always been. May you and I arrive at that place, friends, of trusting in Jesus fully and completely. The words of an Orthodox priest, "The Lord's mastery over this storm is a sign that he is the Messiah. And he is divine. Commands to the sea and waves can only be issued by God alone. And this gospel reminds us that this same almighty hand can and does calm the tempests in each of our souls." That's something, as my grandpa would say, something to hang your hat on. So my brothers and sisters, as we go through our struggles of life, as we have gone through our struggles of life, and as we will continue to in this transitory life, may we rest and trust in Christ. May we rest and trust in his promise. May we remember that the same God, the same Lord who said, "Peace be still," and calm the storm in that hurricane on the lake, that is the same God that you and I have come to worship. That is the same God that you and I bring our hearts, our very lives, our souls, everything we're going through. It is the same Lord whom we bring those to today. May we rest and trust in our Lord Jesus. Alleluia. Amen. In response, I invite us to rise together as we sing. And so, my brothers and sisters, let us now profess and proclaim our faith in the Almighty Lord, whom we place our trust, as we together profess our faith in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and as you are, I invite the handbell choir to come up for their offertory piece this morning. And as they do, we want to thank you for your generous giving here at Victory. It says in Deuteronomy, the Lord says, to give of your first fruits and bring them to me. We do that today. The first of what we receive, we give to the Lord. For as we say, as you've given to us, so we give back unto you. And so if you feel so led to give this morning, you can give via check or cash, an envelope in the box in the back, or online at victorylutheran.ca. So for our offertory, I invite us to turn our attention to our handbell choir.
Thank you.
Thank you, handbells, for those pieces this morning. I invite us to rise together then as a church family. We enter into our ministry of prayer. Brothers and sisters, let us now pray. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. This morning, Lord, we come before your cross, bringing the storms that we have faced in our life that we may be facing in this moment. We don't have all the answers. We don't know all the reasons why. But we come before you. And we ask you, Lord, to fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit that we may find healing, that this morning we may find peace, and that we would enter into a level of deep trust, complete and whole trust in you. We acknowledge this morning, Lord, that you calm the storms, that you are Almighty God, that you are in control. May we worship and praise you each and every day for who you are and for whose we are. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, this morning we thank you that we are a part of something greater than ourselves here at Victory. We thank you for the ministry that is happening here, but we know, Lord, that we are called to a greater kingdom, your kingdom, beyond these four walls. So, Lord, we ask that you would bless the rural churches that we are able to partner with. We ask that you would bless the kingdom of God here in Medicine Hat, each and every church, and all of the ministries that take place. Bless the one holy Catholic and apostolic church that we are a part of. Lord, help us to live out our calling, to live out our faith with all Christians, regardless of which denominational title they may have attached to them. May we work together in unity for the glory of your name. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, as we enter into summer, Lord, we ask that you would be with all kids, from youngest all up through high school and university, as they go on to summer break. We ask, Lord, that you would protect them. Keep them safe. Draw them ever closer to you. Lord, for any children that may feel lonely this summer, may you bring to them good friends. Lord, I pray for all of our kids here at Victory. May they know how much they are loved. I pray that you would be with all teachers, faculty and staff at schools and universities. Give them the rest that they so deserve. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, as we look around at our nation and we look around at our world, so much tumult and chaos that is happening, violence and threats of violence and anger and division. Lord, during these times, we pray for peace. And as we pray for peace, we also pray for leadership, for all those who are leaders. Lord, we ask that you would give them wisdom as they make decisions. And as they make decisions, they would keep always the people whom they are called to serve in front of their minds. And we ask, Lord, that you would give them courage to make the hard decisions when hard decisions need to be made. We pray this over all leaders in government. We pray this over all leaders in church. We pray this over all leaders in businesses, schools, and homes. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, as we began this morning singing about adoring you, about having a heart of worship, Lord, I would pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would give to us, each and every one of us, a heart of worship, that we would be people of thankfulness, people of gratitude, that at each and every turn we would praise your name and bear witness of your love in our lives. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate together the sacrament of Holy Communion, all repentant Christians who believe that the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ comes to us in, with, and under these gifts of bread and wine are welcome at the table. We do offer gluten-free wafers as well as grape juice for anyone that might desire those. And we just ask, if you are coming forward, not to commune, but for a prayer or a blessing, that you just cross your arms over your chest to let us know. Alternatively, according to your conscience, feel free to abstain and remain seated during the sacrament. I do want to share this week, I talked with a person who had left church, grew up in church and then left, wanted nothing to do with it, and just recently came back. And I asked him what it was that drew him back to church, what it was that brought him back. He didn't hesitate. This is what brought him back. He said, communion brought me back to Christ and brought me back to his church. And so I pray this morning that as we celebrate communion together, you as well would be drawn back unto the love, the grace, and the power of Jesus. And so, my brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right. It is our joy and our salvation. Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks, to give you praise, through Jesus Christ, your only Son. Amen. On that night when our Lord and Savior was betrayed, he took bread. And after he had given thanks to his Father in heaven for it, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, for this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way, after supper, he took the cup of wine. And after he had given thanks for it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink, for this is my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and to die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. Amen. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And so let us then together, friends, in power and in unity, pray the prayer that Christ himself taught us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and as you are, invite those assisting to come forward. Please rise together as we pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant that we who have received this sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life now and forever. Amen. leave you with words St. Paul wrote to the Corinthian church. Dear brothers and sisters, I close with these last words. Be joyful. Grow to maturity. Encourage each other. Live in harmony and peace. Then the God of love and peace will be with you. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We conclude our worship singing together, Standing on the Promises. Well, as our final coffee time today, don't forget to stop in for a coffee treat. Say hi to a friend. My dear friends, go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.